Glory, glory be to Jesus. Hallelujah. This morning, bless the name of the Lord. I want to welcome you to church. It's going to be a great time in the presence of the Lord. This is church at Hero Smart, and Hero Smart is a ministry set up by God, as many of you know, for the discipleship of the nations, in keeping with the instruction of Jesus, which says, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I've commanded you to do. And lo, I will be with you up until the end of the age. And in keeping with that instruction in Hero Smart, God has helped us to cover a set of studies that we've titled the Online Discipleship Program, or the ODP in short. We know the ODP is a set of studies that may be classified into four major categories. There is a section of it that we call the pharmacy section of the word. Another part of it we call the milk section of the word. Another part of it we call the water section of the word of God. The pharmacy, the milk, the meat, and the water section of the word of God. And God helped us to get started with another session of the ODP in 2019. And we bless the name of the Lord. It's been great. It's been good so far. Hallelujah. Bless the name of Jesus. We've gone through the pharmacy section of the word. And we are right now in the milk category of the Word of God. The milk category of the Word of God are going to be certain teachings of the Word of God to help the believer to distinguish between good and evil. The Word of God says in the book of Hebrews that some people are not going to be ready to be taken through the meat section of the Word of God because they haven't learned what the writer of the book of Hebrews calls the milk section of the Word of God. And I'm going to like to get started with that instruction, which gives us a catalog of certain teachings of the Word of God that we will pass as the milk section of the Word of God today in Hebrews chapter 5. I'm going to start to read from Hebrews chapter 5, actually, and in verse 11. Hallelujah. You've got your Bible in your hands. Please turn to Hebrews chapter 5 and in verse 11. It says, we have much to say about this, but it is hard to explain because you are slow to learn. And in fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's word all over again. You need milk, not solid food. And anyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness, but solid food is for the mature, who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish between good and evil. Therefore, let us leave the foundational teachings about Christianity, or about Christ, and go on to maturity, not laying again the foundation of repentance from acts that lead to death, and our faith in God and instructions about baptisms, the laying on of hands, resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment, and God permitting we will do so. So God helped the writer of the book of Hebrews to give us a catalog of certain things that we can call the foundational or the milk section of the Word of God over here, as repentance from dead works and faith toward God, instructions about baptisms, the laying on of hands, resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment. And we started a few weeks ago with the first aspect of it called repentance from dead works. And we've gone through two series of that, talking about what repentance is, what dead works are, the types of sins, which we talked about last week, are going to be sins of commission and sins of omission. And sins of commission are going to be express rebellion against explicit instructions of the Word of God. When God tells you something to do right from the pages of the Bible or made known to the law of your conscience and you kick against those express instructions, that's going to be a sin of commission and that's going to lead to death, which is a severance from a right standing relationship with God, and it's going to cause guilt in the recreated human spirit, and you need to learn how to repent of all that. And we talked about how Yahushua noted the process of repentance in John chapter 12 and in verse 40 as three major stages of repentance to deal with such actions of treason. The Word of God lets us know in John chapter 12. We're going to turn to that scripture one more time. How Jesus identifies three major stages of repentance. John chapter 12, and I'm going to start to read from verse 39. It says, "For this reason they could not believe, because Isaiah says elsewhere, he has blinded their eyes and deadened their hearts, so they can neither see with their eyes, nor understand with their hearts, nor turn, and I will heal them." So that passage of scripture identifies three major stages of repentance. There is the seeing eyes that God is going to give you to see, and then there is going to be the turning after you see clearly, and there is going to be another move of God called the healing. So we categorized it into a God's move, a man's move, and a God's move. And all through last week, we're talking about the first part of it, which is the God's move of giving you the seeing eyes to see clearly. If you're listening to messages like this or any other message that carries the anointing on it, and you start listening to those messages, and God starts convicting you of certain things, that I needed to do these things right, and you've not been doing these things right, you've been in rebellion against me, that is a seeing eye that God has given you, and it is a blessing. God is giving you that seeing eyes because he loves you. The Word of God lets us know that God corrects those he loves, and he chastises those that he has accepted. Just like a father, our fathers and around the natural will discipline us momentarily so that we can do better, so that we can do good. The Word of God says in the book of Hebrews that the Father of light disciplines us. If I let's turn to it. It is a blessing of the Lord to get a conviction of the Holy Spirit to tell you to change certain things or to elevate your status of righteousness and to prick your heart about certain things. It is a blessing of the Lord. Because as you're going to see based on the evidence of John chapter 12, in the converse, some people are not going to be able to see clearly. And God says, "I don't want you to see clearly, and as a result, you're not going to be able to turn. And when you do not turn, I'm not going to heal your circumstances." So it is a blessing of the Lord to see clearly. Hallelujah. In Hebrews chapter 12 and in verse 7, he says, "Endure hardship as discipline. God is treating you as sons, and what son is not disciplined by his father? For if you are not disciplined, and everyone undergoes discipline," means there is no escaping it, God's going to do it, "then you are illegitimate children and not true sons. Moreover, we have all had human fathers who discipline us, and we respected them for it. How much more should we submit to the Father of spirits and leave? Our fathers disciplined us for a little while as they thought best, but God disciplined us for our good, that we may share in his holiness. No discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Well, later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it." So God starts his discipline by trying to convict you of certain things in your heart and moving you to a higher level of repentance. And that's the God's move over here. We talked about the seeing eyes, the hearing ears, the understanding heart. The Lord gives them both based on the evidence of Proverbs chapter 20, verse 12, all through last week. It is a blessing of the Lord to give the seeing eyes to you, to give the hearing ears to you, to make your heart understand. It is a blessing of the Lord. And we know that if you're going to let God see, give you the opportunity to see clearly, you got to position your heart not to be like the people who've blinded their eyes over here. In John chapter 12 and in verse 40, it says, "These people, they blinded their eyes, they deadened their hearts, they closed their ears, they wouldn't want to listen to God because of bad attitudes." And the Bible says, only the meek will be taught the ways of the Lord. So when you position yourself in meekness, and God is able to teach you his ways to give you understanding concerning what he needs you to change, that is a blessing of the Lord. And we talked about how God is going to give you certain understandings to open your eyes and disabuse your mind of certain lies of the enemy that the devil may want to use to keep people in bondage and close their hearts to repentance. the deceptions of the enemy concerning perfection is going to be in the future. You don't have to worry about it right now. After all, you're doing better a little bit this year than last year. Deception of the enemy. And we cancel that deception through an understanding of the Word of God in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 48, which says perfect obedience is for now. And we know that different states of perfection, the body of Christ mentioned in the Bible, will be perfect maturity, which is a work in progress as you get exposed to the teachings of the Word of God that are pure and unadulterated. Perfect sanctification is going to be achieved as you obey the Word of God. You are going to receive the life of God like an inheritance to drive out the nature of death from the soul and the body. That is perfect sanctification talked about in 1 Thessalonians 5:23, 2 Corinthians chapter 7 in verse 1. A perfect sanctification, perfect maturity, work in progress for the future, but they are not perfect obedience. Perfect obedience is for now so that you can attain to perfect sanctification and move in the direction of the hope of the Christian calling, which is immortality. And a perfect heart, the Bible says, the eyes of the Lord run to and fro the earth, looking for he whose heart is perfect, so he can show himself strong on their behalf. Perfect heart is for now. Perfect obedience is for now, because those things will help you move in the direction of your destiny. Understanding the different states of perfection talked about in the Bible is going to help you maintain the right kind of perspective so you can see clearly and move into repentance quickly and sustain the operation of perfect obedience. We talked about all that last week. So today we are going to carry on with repentance from dead works. We are going to be talking about part three of it, and trusting that God is going to help us to wrap up the series about repentance from dead works today. This is going to be repentance from dead works part three. Hallelujah. And we're going to be reviewing the process of repentance again with an emphasis on the remaining two aspects of the process of repentance. So God's first move, man's move, and God's move. God's move, just like we read in John chapter 12, is going to be the conviction of the Holy Spirit. The Word of God lets us know when the Holy Spirit comes, it's going to convict the world of sins. Many people know that scripture, but some people may not know that that is a primary ministry of the Holy Spirit right now. In John chapter 16 and in verse 7, hallelujah. Says, but I tell you, it is for your good that I'm going away. Unless I go away, the counselor will not come to you. But if I go away, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will convict the world of guilt in regards to sin and righteousness and judgment. The Word of God says the ministry of the Holy Spirit is to bring that conviction. The Holy Spirit brings that conviction. It's a blessing of the Lord. It is God's first move. The Word of God says in John chapter 6, in verse 44, it says, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last time, last day, letting us know that God draws you. That's the first move of God. You can't come to God. You can't come to terms with repenting from anything that God's telling you to repent from, except God draws you, except God gives you to see clearly. That's God's first move. The conviction of the Holy Spirit, the giving of the seeing eyes, the hearing ears, the understanding heart. God's first move is a token of God's love to draw people into repentance. We talked about all that all through last week. The second part of it is going to be man's move, which man's move is going to be to respond appropriately to the conviction of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. So when God is convicting my heart about something, I'm not just going to try to cover it up and say, well, it doesn't matter, and shrug it under the shrug my shoulders and just walk away from it and talk it under the carpet and say it doesn't matter. No, that's not a proper response. The proper response is, yes, sir, you're right. I justify you in all my ways, my Father. You are right in this situation. Man's move is the second stage of repentance, And we talked about that being equivalent to the turning that Jesus was talking about in John chapter 12 and in verse 40. And man's move is going to include honesty, humility, and faith, which honesty is going to include acknowledging the voice of God in the conscience, admitting to the conviction of the Holy Spirit, not debating with God about it, or giving excuses for actions of treason. Admitting to the scripture that God has used to convict your heart and finding subsequent scriptures that you are going to use to operate faith principles to receive your repentance. Because the process of repentance is simple, but it is technical. And if you do not understand all those technicalities that we're talking about, which may be activated in less than 30 seconds if you've mastered it, you will be like some of our brothers back at the turn of the last century, who will weep and wail at the altar, asking for God to forgive them of their sins and never receiving repentance. And they never receive repentance because they don't understand how to receive repentance and forgiveness through the blood of Jesus. So it is really technical. You don't understand how technical it is, and that's the reason we're trying to talk about it. If it's not technical, how come Judas felt remorseful? He felt really sorry for what he did, for betraying Jesus, and he never repented. Oh yeah, Judas cried and wept just like Peter cried and wept, and Peter was remorseful, and he was able to repent, but Judas was remorseful and he couldn't repent. How come? If repentance wasn't technical, if certain things couldn't be activated to make sure you receive forgiveness from God, how come Judas couldn't repent and Peter repented? Let's look at that scripture. Matthew chapter 26, talking about the evidence of Peter. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Bless the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. God is teaching us how to repent so we can sustain the status of perfect obedience in our lives going forward. Hallelujah. And verse 75, Matthew chapter 26, and in verse 75, the Word of God says, immediately a rooster crowed that Peter remembered the word of Jesus. The word Jesus had spoken to him before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times. And he went outside and wept bitterly. If you've got a paper copy of the Bible in your hands, I want to implore you please to underline, Peter remembered the word of Jesus. That's going to be the key differentiator. Now, if you flip just a few verses into chapter 27, and you're going to see in verse 3, and contrast the operation of Peter's remorsefulness with Judas's remorsefulness, you will appreciate what I'm talking about with regards to the fact that repentance is technical. In Matthew chapter 27 and in verse 3, when Judas, who had betrayed him, saw that Jesus was condemned, he was seized with remorse. And he returned the 30 pieces of silver that he got from the chief priests and the elders. And he said, I have sinned, he said, for I have betrayed innocent blood. And what is that to us? They replied, that's your responsibility. So Judas threw the money down in the temple and left, and he went and hanged himself. So look at that. Peter was just as remorseful as Judas, but Peter received forgiveness because he remembered the words that Jesus spoke to him. But Judas, even though he felt remorseful, he didn't remember any word of God in him. There was no scripture to move Judas into faith in the blood of Jesus to receive forgiveness. And he went and he hanged himself. Technical difference. That's the reason we're talking about an HHF response as your move, man's move, when you respond to the conviction of the Holy Spirit in your heart. Repentance is simple, but it is technical. That's the reason you got to learn it. You're going to learn how to repent and don't be like some of our brothers at the turn of the last century who would spend 4 hours at the altar confessing their sins and not receiving forgiveness because they didn't understand how to exercise faith in the blood of bulls and goats, in the blood of Jesus rather. Like the people of the Old Testament exercise faith in the blood of bulls and goats to purge their conscience. Technical. Hallelujah. When you understand what I'm talking about right now, you'll appreciate that God is not trying to condemn you. God is not saying that you are worthless. The conviction of the Holy Spirit is not talking about condemnation. It's talking about I needed to change certain things so you can reconfigure your heavenlies and so I can bring your healing again. Because I don't see you as the author of sin. I see the devil as the author of sin. I'm trying to snatch you away from the music the devil is trying to play for you. Glory to God. That's the reason we're spending so much time to trying to talk about it, because I don't want you to be like a Judas over here. Judas didn't have any word of God in him. Anytime Yahushua was preaching about the word of God, what's Judas thinking about? Judas is going to be thinking about how to steal money from the offering. And Yahushua knew about it. So that boy is always trying to help himself with the offering basket. He had the finances of the ministry. He's going to try to steal something from that. Thinking about how to gain something from the ministry of Jesus. Always the carnal mode every time. Not thinking about the word of God. He didn't care. Yahushua's going to be preaching the storm for 3 days. Where's Judas? What's Judas thinking about? Everything entered through one ear and left through the other ear. No word resident inside Judas. And that's the reason he couldn't repent. He did something that stupid. He was moved into remorsefulness and he went and hanged himself. And Peter, on the other hand, soaking in all the word. And he missed it. He rebelled against the voice of God in his conscience and denied Jesus. And when the Holy Spirit convicted him, he was sorry for what he did, but he didn't hang himself. That word was his bastion, moved him in faith. So I believe that Jesus is going to take me back. And he went and he repented. What was the word that Peter remembered? Yahushua told Peter, the devil desires to sift you. But I pray for you that your faith will not fail. And when your faith doesn't fail, bring your brothers back together again. So Peter remembered those words and said, wow, Jesus is going to take me back even though I'm feeling sorry right now. There is no point in going back to hang myself. Father, forgive me. He moved into repentance and he came back and became a pillar in the church of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Repentance is a good thing. It is simple. It is technical. You got to learn how to repent today if God convicts you of anything in your heart. Hallelujah. So man's move is what we're going to be talking about today. We talked about God's move all through last week. The second part of it is going to be man's move, which is going to be based on honesty, humility, and faith. What is the honesty aspect of it? Acknowledging the voice of God in your conscience. Admitting to the conviction of the Holy Spirit and do not debate with God about it. If it is in your conscience, a violation of God's moral standard revealed to your conscience. It is a legitimate guilt to your conscience. And God is telling you, I need you to change certain things over here. You're going to say, yes, sir. That's not a time to say, well, God, but you know, Mr. X is doing the same thing down the road. Mrs. B is trying to do the same thing. Why are you getting on me about it? Don't talk about that. Don't talk like that to God. That's going to be dishonesty. That's not going to be a proper response to what God is trying to move you to, because God is trying to elevate your standard of righteousness and bring a greater blessing into your life by telling you, I needed to change certain things right now. Child of God, move into honesty. Oh, what about if it is illegitimate guilt in my heart? I'm eating meat and some people preach I shouldn't eat meat, but I find myself eating meat right now and God doesn't really care about that. You're going to see the voice of God in your conscience telling you to know like God knows so you can overcome that situation. We're not talking about illegitimate guilt right now. Illegitimate guilt, you do not overcome it by repentance. Illegitimate guilt, you overcome it based on what 1 John 3 talked about. You know like God knows in that situation. You disabuse your mind of all the lies of the enemy and move to do whatever God is telling you to do in faith. You know like God knows you destroy illegitimate guilt like that. But legitimate guilt, the only way you're going to get rid of it is through repentance, what I'm talking about right now. Oh, but how do I know if it's legitimate guilt or not legitimate guilt? We talked about how you want to judge thoughts based on consistency with the character of God. Talked about that overcomer secret. You're going to ask whatever is in your conscience right now. Is this particular action that I did going to promote kindness and justice and righteousness? I gave an example yesterday to my wife, and I was telling her, well, there are going to be times when God is going to tell you, well, you don't need to eat anymore. And there are going to be times that God is going to tell you, well, you can eat, but you're still feeling bad that, well, I thought God told me not to eat anymore. How do I know when to stop eating? How do I know when to continue eating? Well, you're going to ask yourself, when I eat right now, is that going to promote kindness or righteousness and justice in my life? How will I know that? Oh, yeah, because God created food. And he expected you to eat so he can have strength. If you're a nursing mother, he expects you to eat so he can feed your baby properly. He expects you to eat so he can pray. So when you eat and you get physical energy to pray properly, and you can do the things God's telling you to do, you are promoting kindness and justice and righteousness. Eat, child of God, and be blessed, and bless your food, and don't raise any conscience, any questions about it in your conscience. Hallelujah. So if the devil is trying to tell you, well, you're meant to be fasting, well, I'm not meant to be fasting right now because I'm meant to nurse my baby. I need to eat. When you have that complete understanding, he's going to destroy illegitimate guilt in your heart. You're not going to feel bad about it anymore. That's how to deal with illegitimate guilt. You know why God knows in that situation, by judging that particular situation with consistency, with the character of God, kindness and justice and righteousness. Jeremiah chapter 9, verse 23 and 24 says, if anybody wants to boast that he knows me, he should boast that he knows I'm a God who exercises myself in simultaneous displays of kindness, of justice, and righteousness. For in all these things I delight in all the earth. Everything God's going to do, which is inclusive of the conviction of the Holy Spirit, will have those three things in it. If God is trying to convict you of a certain thing that you're not doing right, it's because there is either kindness or justice missing in your action in that particular instance. Or maybe righteousness is missing or kindness is there. Maybe all of the three are missing. So you judge that situation to determine which one is legitimate guilt and which one is not legitimate guilt. Hallelujah. And once you bring that light of the Word of God back up into your mind, illegitimate guilt is going to fall away. Why are we talking about repentance? I do not want you to become like some of our brethren at the turn of the last century who will weep and wail at the altar without faith and still not receive forgiveness and live the rest of their lives either in legitimate guilt or illegitimate guilt, and they can't serve God properly. And they do all their actions without faith. The Word of God says without faith it is impossible to please God. And because you don't know like God knows everything you're doing, you're eating your food without faith. You're praying without faith. You're singing a song without faith. You're doing this without faith. You can't please God like that. You got to serve God in faith, knowing fully sure that my conscience is clean and clear by the blood of Jesus. I've received forgiveness and I am reconfiguring my heaviness for a healing right now in the circumstances. Know for sure the way God knows that's how to deal with illegitimate guilt in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. But legitimate guilt, you got to walk through the stage of repentance. These stages of repentance right now to deal with it. Because if you do not deal with it like that, he said, well, a legitimate guilt is an illegitimate guilt. And you shrug your shoulders and you try to talk it on the carpet and thinking that the guilt in your conscience is going to disappear just because you ignore it. It will not. Well, I'm just going to resist legitimate guilt and talk to him the carpet like he doesn't exist. You can't resist God. God is he's got a sense of humor. The Word of God says, submit to God, resist the devil, and he's going to flee from you. And you try to say, well, I'm not going to submit to God. I'm going to try to resist the so-called thing that I think is the devil, but it's actually God bringing conviction into your heart. God's not going to flee from you. You can't resist God. Hallelujah. So that's the reason it's important to identify, is this a legitimate guilt or illegitimate guilt? How do I know if it's a legitimate guilt? A legitimate guilt is going to be a violation of the character of God. Illegitimate guilt is not going to be a violation of the character of God, but it's in my heart because of wrong understanding. I've disabused my mind right now that wrong understanding by a complete counsel, complete understanding the word of God. Illegitimate guilt's going to follow me. The legitimate guilt, I'm going to tackle that by this process of repentance right now in the name of Jesus. Man's move to destroy and to overcome the dead work of sins of commission, which will produce legitimate guilt inside the recreated human spirit, because the Holy Spirit wants you to change something. The first thing you need to do is to acknowledge the voice of God in your conscience, and that is honesty. The second thing you want to do is to move in humility by submitting to the truth that honesty has revealed, inclining your will to turn and to change, and making a decision to change. Hallelujah. And then you want to move into faith. Remember, through the study of the Overcomer Secret, honesty is going to be admitting to the voice of God in your conscience. God has revealed his standard of morality to your conscience. Right at the age of accountability, the law of the Lord. Love God and love people. Make known to your conscience. Regardless of whatever color of skin you have on this side of eternity, black, brown, yellow, pink, blue, shape, whatever shape or color you have in between those, you have the voice of God telling you in your conscience his standard of morality. And when you violate God's standard of morality, there is going to be a conviction of the Holy Spirit in your heart to tell you something is wrong. And you, in honesty, you're going to say, yes, sir, I admit it. I was wrong. When you admit to that, that is honesty. And when you incline your will to make a change, that's humility. And God's going to reward that exercise with a unique understanding to give you faith to change. Because change is going to happen because you have faith in the Word of God to receive forgiveness and strength in your heart, so that you can overcome subsequent repeats of the test, because they will come back, so you can gain your crown of life back. Which scriptures talk about all this? Let's go to 1 John chapter 1 and verse 9 to start with. And understand how God expects you to move in honesty and humility and in faith to receive forgiveness of your sins, to move in the direction of repentance from dead works. Glory to God. In 1 John chapter 1 and verse 9, it says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. The Word of God says, if we confess, that confessing over there is honesty. That is acknowledging that this is wrong. I'm going to call a spade. This is wrong. And it'll be the beat around the bush about it. God's standard of morality is made known to your conscience. Don't beat around the bush about it. You're going to say, this is wrong. That's confessing it. Hallelujah. And on the scripture in the book of Hebrews, in Hebrews chapter 9. Glory to God. Hebrews chapter 9 and in verse 13, it says, the blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of heifer sprinkled on those who are ceremonially unclean sanctify them, so that they are outwardly clean. How much more then will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our consciences from acts that lead to death, so that we may serve the living God. The Word of God says the blood of bulls and goats could purge the flesh of those who offered it back in the Old Testament. And how much more will the blood of Jesus do the same thing for you in the New Testament if you put your faith in the blood of Jesus? You read the scriptures to yourself after you've confessed and have acknowledged. You reserve the right to receive your forgiveness based on the scriptures right now. Based on these two scriptures. Hallelujah. It says, how much more will the blood of Christ? Having to say, through the blood of Jesus, I receive my forgiveness right now in the name of Jesus. And it's going to be like magic. That guilt is going to disappear from your conscience. You're going to be like, wow. I'm not feeling bad anymore. Glory to God. That's what the blood of Jesus was designed for, to remove guilt from your conscience. And all of a sudden, you're not going to feel bad about it. And that's the reason some of our people are trying to, oh, well, I can just do that again. Oh, Lord. Glory to God. I'm just going to go ahead and do it. The blood of Jesus is going to work that magic. Yes. The blood of Jesus was designed to do that. But on top of you receiving forgiveness, it's important for you to understand that you're going to have to repeat the test so that you can cancel out the afflictions that are going to be coming into your circumstances because of the evil of treason. So you don't play around with it. Don't play games with it. Say, so, well, I'm just going to go ahead and commit that sin again. The blood of Jesus is going to cleanse me. No. Don't fool around with God like that. Don't do that. You don't want to do that. We're talking about if you miss it, prevention or something like that, you quickly change it. You don't ever have an intention to repeat that action of treason anymore. And God's going to be there with the blood of Jesus to cleanse your conscience and give you life. Hallelujah. And we're going to talk about that a little bit today. Proverbs chapter 28, another cardinal scripture you got to have in your pocket to activate the principle of repentance real quickly so that you can receive forgiveness through faith in the blood of Jesus. Glory to God. Proverbs chapter 28 and in verse 13, it says, he who covers his sins shall not prosper. But he who confesses and forsakes, then shall receive mercy. So that word confessing is honesty, forsaking is humility, and you receive mercy through faith. That's the reason HHF is going to be a part of what you need to do. Hallelujah. So there's three scriptures. Please bookmark them in your Bible. Or better still, take a note of them. Just write them down so you can move into repentance quickly. If God is convicting your heart concerning anything you might have done, receive forgiveness and undo it again. 1 John 1:9, Hebrews 9:13 to 14, Proverbs chapter 28 and verse 13. Really, really cardinal scriptures to make you receive the cleansing of your conscience from dead works. What are the stages? What are the steps you're going to take? You're going to say, I ask for forgiveness based on the word of God in faith. And I receive forgiveness based on the word of God in faith. Then you are going to ask for the cleansing of your conscience from this dead work and guilt by the blood of Jesus. You are going to receive the cleansing of your conscience in faith. And then you are going to subsequently ask for grace and mercy to receive strength to pass and repeat of the test, to temper the demands of negative judgment activated by actions of treason, and to sustain the operation of agape toward the God kind of love. And get ready for a repeat of the test. Because when the test gets repeated in your circumstances, you got to pass that test and retrieve traded authority and dislodge Satan from your heavenlies. And that's the complete truth of it, which lots of people in the body of Christ do not talk about. It's not going to do you a whole lot of good if I were to tell you the blood of Jesus is going to clean your conscience to restore your right standing after you committed actions of treason, and that's the end of the story. No, that's not the end of the story. You need a healing of your circumstances right now, and the only way you're going to get a healing of your circumstances is if you receive the wages of righteousness as an inheritance. Because the wages of sin is going to bring death, and you need the wages of righteousness to bring you life. Oh, but I thought the Bible said the wages of sin is going to bring death, but the free gift of God is eternal life. So I don't need to expect to have to do anything to receive the life of God. Incomplete. Let's look at that scripture. In Romans chapter 5, the word of God says the wages of sin is death. The free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus Christ our Lord. Romans chapter 6, rather. Hallelujah. Oh, glory, 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 glory to Jesus. Many people are excited about the word of God. Glory to God. Romans chapter 6 and in verse 23, it says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. So reading that passage of scripture, that verse of scripture in isolation, is going to make you assume erroneously that the salary or the wage of sin, which is death, is going to be canceled out by the free gift of righteousness. But that is incomplete. The free gift of righteousness is going to give you the life of God in your spirit through the operation of faith in the blood of Jesus. But there's got to be another wage of life, a wage of righteousness that you are going to get to give your life as an inheritance to cancel out the misconfiguration of your heavenlies right now. That's the complete counsel of God. Hallelujah. Let's look at in Romans chapter 6 and in verse 11. It says, in the same way count yourselves dead indeed unto sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore do not let sin reign in your mortal body, so that you obey its evil desires. Do not offer the parts of your body to sin as instruments of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life. Offer the parts of your body to life as instruments of righteousness, for sin shall not be your master. Hallelujah. And I'm going to start reading verse 15 right now. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? By no means. Don't you know that when you offer yourselves to somebody to obey him as slaves, you are slaves to the one whom you obey. Whether you are slaves to sin, which leads to death, that's talking about the wages of it, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that though you used to be slaves of sin, you wholeheartedly obeyed the former teaching to which you were entrusted. You've been set free from sin and have become slaves of righteousness. I put this in your human terms because you're weak in your natural selves. Just as you used to offer the parts of your body, this is where I'm going, listen carefully, in slavery to impurity and to ever-increasing wickedness, so now offer them in slavery to righteousness, leading to holiness. Hallelujah. When you were slaves of sin, you were free from the control of righteousness. What benefit did you reap from that? At that time of things you're now ashamed of. Those things result in death. But now that you've been set free from sin and have become slaves of God, the benefit you reap leads to holiness, and the result is eternal life. Can you see over there? So there is another mode of the life of God that obedience is going to give you. Even though verse 23 is talking about receiving the life of God, the free gift. So what am I talking about? What's the whole counsel of God in it? So you are going to receive the free gift of righteousness, the free gift of the life of God, through the faith in the blood of Jesus to cleanse your conscience, and at the same time receive obedience, the life of God, as a result and reward for obedience to work in your circumstances and reconfigure your heavenlies. And that truth of the word of God is going to position you to resist the devil when another opportunity for offense shows up in your circumstances. Because the devil is going to come and God's going to allow him to bring that repeat of the test, whatever that situation may be. And God's going to allow him to bring that for a good reason. Because God wants you to beat him up and retrieve traded authority and get Satan to fall away from your heavens. Yahushua says, I saw Satan fall like lightning from the skies. What happened? When you retrieve authority from the devil, he loses his foothold in your heavens and he's going to fall from the skies. But unfortunately, lots of people submit to him, and he climbs up again to their skies, and he occupies places in their heavens. But when you retrieve authority and you say no to him, what you just did is you dislodge the devil from your heavens, and your angels can bring the answers to your prayers unhindered. That's the reason the second part of you passing the test, and that information is important. You need to know about it. The blood of Jesus is important, but you passing the repeat of the test is just as important. And that's the complete counsel of the word, which will keep you in the straight and narrow. And he's going to position you to pass the test when another opportunity for offense shows up. So when you want to exercise faith to receive forgiveness, to receive the cleansing of your conscience, if you find yourself needing to repent from any treason, ask for forgiveness and receive by faith. Number one, ask for the cleansing of your conscience and receive by faith. Number two, ask for grace and mercy so that you can receive strength and so that you can be positioned to pass the test when another opportunity shows up in your circumstances. Number three, real critical operation of faith principles you need to master. Ask for forgiveness received by faith. Ask for the cleansing of your conscience received by faith. Ask for grace and mercy to pass the test when another opportunity shows up, and receive that grace and mercy by faith, and get ready and dare the devil to bring it on your circumstances again, and God will allow him to bring it on. And when he brings it on, seize the moment to practice righteousness right now. And you pass the test in flying colors, and what happens after that, you've retrieved traded authority, and you've dislodged the devil from your heavenlies, and you've reconfigured your circumstances right now to cancel and neutralize the effect of the treason. Because once you commit treason, you are going to activate the demonic in your second heavenlies, and they are going to bring afflictions in your world. You want to cancel that. Oh, but I think God's just going to cancel that from the blood of Jesus. No! The blood of Jesus was not designed to reconfigure your circumstances. What is designed to reconfigure your circumstances is obedience and the life of God that you get as a reward for obedience to the truth of the God kind of love, and that is your inheritance. Hallelujah. That's man's move. Glory to God. And then after you've done that, God's move is going to step to the scene again. What is God's final move? Remember, God's move, man's move, and God's move. God's final move is going to step up to bring a healing. John chapter 12 verse 40 says, if you turn, then I will heal you. 2 Chronicles chapter 7 in verse 14, it says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, then I will heal them. Let's turn to that scripture. Really cardinal scripture to let you know that there is a third aspect of the process of repentance. 2 Chronicles in chapter 7. Hallelujah. And in verse 14. It says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn and repent from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sins, and I will heal their land. So that's God's third move. God's third move includes the forgiveness, includes the hearing from heaven, and the healing. There's going to be supernatural healing of your conscience if you do what I'm talking about right now with precision. And God does it through the blood of Jesus. Supernatural removal of guilt from your conscience. Why will God do that? God is going to do that because guilt blocks your right standing. And when your right standing or your righteousness is blocked, life can flow into your spirit again. Very well. Sometimes it's a little bit cluttered up and it can flow just in trickles, but not very well. And when the life of God is not able to flow into your spirit very well, you cannot have enough spiritual energy to charge back at the devil and continue your service of God. So it is in God's interest to cleanse you and give you right standing again after you've repented of your sins. It makes a lot of sense, and God wants to do that. So that's the reason God's going to remove that guilt from your spirit, restore your right standing, release Zoe water into the recreated human spirit, which is the process of the grace of God talked about in Romans chapter 5 in verse 17 to 21. And then release Zoe in the form of his mercy into your circumstances to temper the demands of negative judgment activated because of your sins and reorchestrate circumstances to bring a repeat of the text. We're talking about God's final move right now. God's going to make all these moves to restore and to heal. And subsequently, when you pass the test, God's going to release Zoe as an inheritance after you pass the test, and this is the anointing upon. The Bible says the path of the righteous is like the light that shines brighter and brighter until the perfect day. Prior to now, lots of people in the body of Christ have just interpreted Zoe to mean the rivers of living waters. And that's correct. But that's the fundamental state of the life of God. And Zoe, as the rivers of living water, is required for the womb of your spirit. But there are other forms of the life of God. And when we get to start talking about faith toward God for divine life, we're going to see all these things. And based on the evidence of the tabernacle of Moses as well, you're going to see there is the life of God like an anointing oil that is poured on the priest. There is the life of God like incense spices. There is the life of God like streams of water. All those things have unique purposes. The life of God that you get inside your heart is not designed to reconfigure your circumstances for you. It's designed to give you spiritual energy. When you get to obey the word of God, you will receive the life of God as a seed of resurrection in your physical body and in your soul. That is what we call the anointing upon, which is going to sanctify your members and sanctify your circumstances and bring a healing. That's what we're talking about over here. And God is going to have to give you that measure of the life of God as a reward for obedience or as a wage for righteousness that we read in Romans chapter 6. So that is God's final move. So if I understand that the way God's going to completely neutralize the effect of my treason is going to include me passing the repeats of the test, even after I've received my forgiveness, even after there is no guilt in my spirit anymore, even after there is a right standing right now relationship in my heart, that knowledge is the complete counsel of the Word of God and is going to keep you on a straight and narrow path. What happens if you do not understand there is a God's final move to orchestrate and reorchestrate and repeat of the test for you, and you just go based on the notion that once you plead the blood of Jesus, everything is done and over with. Platform for addictions. Platform for a repeat of the scandal. Platform for a repeat of the treason. That's the story of many people in the body of Christ. And even though supposedly they get forgiven of their sins. And what's going to happen is because you keep on playing games with God like that, you are going to sear your conscience up until the time that you can't even repent anymore. Just because of this erroneous understanding that the blood of Jesus is all you need to neutralize the effect of your sins. Of course not. It wasn't designed to do that. The blood of Jesus was designed to give you righteousness in your heart. But you need obedience to neutralize the misconfiguration of your circumstances on the outside, and that's the complete truth of the Word of God. I'm beating hard on this because this is going to be a cardinal understanding to set millions and billions of people free all over this planet right now if you understand the whole complete counsel of God concerning the process of repentance. Hallelujah. I'm going to turn to a case study of the woman with the alabaster box. To make people understand, it is important for you to seize the moment to obey the word when another opportunity for offense shows up in your circumstances. Luke chapter 7. Bless the name of Jesus. We're going to turn to Luke chapter 7 in verse 36. Talking about the woman of the alabaster box who anointed Yahushua. With oil and perfume. In chapter 7 of Luke. And in verse 36. Now one of the Pharisees invited Yahushua to have dinner with him. So he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at a table. When a woman who had lived a sinful life in that town learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster jar of perfume, and as she stood behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears, and she wiped them with her hair and kissed them and poured perfume on them. When the Pharisee who had invited Yahushua saw these, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner." And Yahushua answered him, "Simon, I have something to tell you." "Tell me, teacher," he said. "Two men owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii, the other 50. And neither of them had the money to pay him back. So he canceled the debts of both. Now which of them will love him more? Simon replied, I suppose the one who had the bigger debt canceled. You have judged correctly, Jesus said. Then he turned toward the woman and said, Simon, do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet. But she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me any keys. But this woman from the time I entered has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, for she's loved much. But to he who's been forgiven little, even loves little. Then Jesus said to her, your sins are forgiven. And Yahushua said, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Underline verse 47 to verse 50, right there, of Luke chapter 7. Yahushua says, because she loved much, her sins have been forgiven. But I thought she offered the blood of bulls and whatever they used to offer back in the Old Testament just a few weeks ago when Yahushua saved her from being stoned to death. She was forgiven at that instance. But how come Jesus is saying right now, your sins have been forgiven because you love much right now? How come Jesus had to say that? The reason Jesus had to say that is because she seized an opportunity to cancel. Right now, the effect of the afflictions that she configured all the while in her circumstances to bring, because she seized an opportunity to practice obedience to the truth of the God kind of love. And that's the lesson we need to learn from here. How about just committed so many sins? How would she cancel everything out? The way you cancel everything out is to seize opportunities to love God and love people. Oh, does she have to go back and make restitution? Some people, they want to turn back to the Old Testament and say, well, if you stole somebody, then you got to go give it back and make restitution. What about if the person you stole it from is dead? How do you make restitution? What's important is you seize opportunities subsequently in your future to pass any task that God brings in your future right now to obey God, to love God, to love people, and that will neutralize the effect of any sins of the past, whether it looks like in the same similitude or not. When I'm talking about similitude, I'm talking about the same semblance of the sin or not. You can cancel it by obedience to the truth of the God kind of love. And that's what we need to learn from the story of this woman. The woman was convicted of her sins. She acknowledged God's conviction. She repented and received the cleansing and forgiveness by faith. Opportunity was presented to her to undo the effect of her sins. And she seized the opportunity presented to her to practice obedience to the truth of the God kind of love. And the effects of her sins were nullified in the heavenlies. You need to learn from that. The question you're going to ask yourself is, what about if the opportunity for this woman to practice love toward the master wasn't presented to her? Or what about if the opportunity was presented to her and she did not seize the opportunity to obey the truth of God kind of love? Will the effect of her sins be neutralized to the extent that Jesus was talking about here? The answers to those questions, of course, is going to be no. If the opportunity was presented to the woman and she did not seize that opportunity to practice obedience to the truth of the God kind of love, there will still be afflictions in her circumstances, even though she was forgiven of her sins. Reality. The life of God you need to reconfigure your heavenlies, to cancel out the effect of afflictions, is not the river of water. It is an inheritance of Zoe that we call the anointing upon which you need to get as a reward for doing righteousness. Hallelujah. Tight but right. So it is important to appreciate this process of repentance and all the nuggets around it so that we can stay in the realm of status, in the realm of perfect obedience, which is for now and forever. The blood of Jesus was not designed to reconfigure circumstances. Rather, it was designed to cleanse the human conscience of guilt, bad feelings, the fears in there, the feelings of, I don't think I'm doing something, all that bad feelings on the inside will be cleansed if you have faith in the blood of Yahushua for a subsequent restoration of a right standing relationship with the Father God. And afterwards, obedience is going to be required to cancel out the effect of a misconfigured heavenlies. Because the wages of sin is death, the free gift of grace restores right standing, and the wages of obedience will bring life in the form of the anointing upon to completely neutralize the effect of misdeeds. We looked at the case study of the alabaster box woman, and God gave us further insight in the story and in the chapter of Romans chapter 6 to let us know the whole counsel of God involves a wage of righteousness and the free gift of the life of God on the inside. Zoe water and a wage of righteousness. Zoe water, a wage of righteousness. Zoe water, a wage of righteousness to cancel out the effect of my sins. And when you have that understanding, it's going to position you not to repeat the misdeed of treason in your future. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Repentance from dead works. With this understanding, and you take all these things we're talking about, and you pray about them, God's going to give you the strength and the resolve to say no to the devil when another opportunity for offense shows up in your circumstances. Darkness covers the world and grows darkness to people. This is a season of darkness, and it's a season in which God's wrath is going to escalate because of that darkness. Because the Father of Light is not going to back down on his standard just because our generation seemingly can't get it right. And the story is not going to end like this. This generation is going to be saved because prophetically, God is going to let the man child rise up, and people are going to be turning to the man child to learn the ways of the Lord. And I'm believing God for this generation that people are going to learn how to perfect the understanding of the mechanics of obedience and sustain the operation of perfect obedience in their lives, because that's the mandate that we were given as members of the body of Christ. And you can be a part of it. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I'm trusting and believing with you that you will maintain the status of perfect obedience as a baby, as a child, as a young man, as a father, or whatever level of spiritual maturity you may find yourself in there, you will say yes, sir, to God every time. Why? So that you can configure your heavenlies for the blessing of God that God is bringing in your life and cancel out the afflictions of the enemy. Why? Because the curse costless shall not arise. In the same way a blessing causeless will not alight, but a blessing with a cause for it will alight in your circumstances, and a curse will be canceled, because right now you're obeying the word of God to cancel the curse in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Bless the name of the Lord, somebody. Did you get something out of it? I believe you got something out of it today. So we talked about repentance from dead works, part 3. I talked about overview of the process of repentance, which is going to be a God's move, firstly, to convict you of your sin, the treason that you might have committed, then man's move, which is going to be operating HHF, honesty, humility, and faith. All those three things are important. The Word of God says in John chapter 12 that some people cannot believe because they can't see clearly. So it means after seeing clearly, it is important to see clearly, and after seeing clearly, you got to step into the faith mode. That's the reason the F is part of it. It's not just H and H. It is HHF. F is part. You got to move in faith. You got to receive in faith. Don't be like the people at the turn of the century, wailing at the altar, feeling convicted of their sins, but they cannot receive in faith because they don't trust the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus is a miracle worker. He will remove that guilt from your spirit and give you strength on the inside again after right standing is restored to position you to pass the test in flying colors. Glory to Jesus. So thank God for the blood of Jesus. Thank God for the blood of Yahushua. He speaks better than the blood of bulls and goats and the blood of Abel, and is working on your behalf if you have faith in the blood of Yahushua. Glory to God. And then God's final move is going to step to play to give you forgiveness, restore right standing, reorchestrate circumstances, and bring the test so you can pass it again and reconfigure your heavenlies and neutralize the effects of afflictions in your world. So this is where I'm going to like to stop today, and I want to give the viewing audience an opportunity to take a snapshot of the study notes on the board so you can study along with us. So whatever device you're working with right now, just go ahead and pause that device and quickly take a snapshot of the study notes on the board, and I'll be back in 10 seconds. Oh, praise the Lord, somebody. Praise the Lord. I believe you got a chance to take a copy of the study notes on the board. And this is where I'm going to like to stop today. This is Repentance from Dead Works, Part 3. I believe you got something out of it. And we're going to continue with the study of the middle section of the Word of God next week with faith toward God. And I say, be blessed in the name of Yahushua. Amen.